Okay, good evening, everybody. My name is Rachel, Rachel Kolsky, and I'm not from Hackney. I don't live in Stoke Newington, but shock horror, outrageous. But some years ago, I went on a walking tour with somebody called Sean Gubbins. I'm sure some, I don't know if he's here, but some of you might know him. And he was just totally inspirational about Hackney, and I sort of began sort of exploring myself and sort of walking all around Hackney. But I have a particular interest in the Jewish community in London and the wider sphere. And the thing about the Jewish community in Hackney is that it really became the successor to the Jewish East End. If people actually think about Jewish London, the image that most people always think of is the Jewish East End, in and around Whitechapel, Stepney, Mile End, and oh, there he is. And nothing wrong at all about that. But people always think that the move away from the Jewish East End to the suburbs happened, people always say, at the time of the growth of the tube lines, particularly the Northern Line, you know, into northwest London, and then post-war along the Central Line into sort of Essex. But actually, the move from the East End began much earlier than that, and the Jewish community began moving directly north from the East End into what we know today as Hackney, but particularly Hackney Central around Mare Street, and then into Stoke Newington and Stamford Hill. And by the 1940s, 1950s, Hackney, Jewish Hackney, was probably as large numerically and as buoyant and as vibrant and as having as many organisations and establishments linked to the Jewish community as the Jewish East End had been. So if you had 125,000 in East End, you had well over 100,000 in Hackney. So one can do lots of different talks about lots of different bits of Jewish Hackney, but as this is a Stoke Newington sort of history celebration, Amir asked me to talk about Jewish Stoke Newington. And I need to do a bit of damage limitation just before I begin, in the sense that Jewish Stoke Newington, there's a little bit of overlap between Jewish Stamford Hill. And remember, actually, you never have to say Jewish Stamford Hill. If you say to somebody, where are you visiting, or where do you live, Stamford Hill, I know it's a multicultural area, but most people today consider it almost linked totally with the Haredi community, the ultra-Orthodox community. So first of all, I've got to say that some of you might be expecting to hear about certain things, but I might have labelled them Stoke Newington, you might label them Stamford Hill. And I've met a lot of people over the years and sort of interrogated them about where they lived and where they brought up, and they'll say Stoke Newington, and I'll ask them the name of the street, and then I'll invite somebody else to, share their memories, and they lived in exactly the same street, but they said they lived in Stamford Hill. So there's a little bit of overlap, and but I'm really concentrating on sort of the western side, I think I got that right, of the A10, just with one building that isn't in the Stoke Newington area. To give you an idea of how complicated Stoke Newington and Stamford Hill can be in the Jewish world, we actually have a Lord Glassman in the House of Lords. Some of you might know him, Maurice Glassman. When he chose his name, when he was ennobled, he chose his title as Lord Glassman of Stoke Newington and Stamford Hill. So he basically wanted to cover both bases, because he's very, very diplomatic and very, very politically astute. But he's a Hackney boy. He born and brought up in the area. He went to Clapton Jewish Day School, which is now the Simon Marks Primary School on Cousinov Road. Went to JFS and of course went off to Cambridge, worked abroad, and then came back and became very much part of sort of blue, what they used to call blue Labour. But just his choice of name really gives an indication of how complicated it can be. And it gets even more complicated in the Jewish world, particularly here in Stoke Newington, Stamford Hill, because I don't know if any of you recognise this building. This is, today it's a mosque, and it's the Stoke Newington Mosque, just off the main road. It was built in 1903 as Stoke Newington Synagogue, even though it's actually in Dalston, so some of you will know it. And the reason it had to be called Stoke Newington Synagogue, even though it was in Dalston, is because the Dalston Synagogue already existed, but it was actually in Newington Green on Pellet's Road. On Poets Road. So that's why you've got Stoke Newington Synagogue in Dalston. Opened in 1903, and this was showing even in the very early 20th century, that the Jewish community was moving in large numbers to Hackney, moving to Dorset, Stoke Newington areas. This is a magnificent synagogue designed by Lewis Solomon, who was one of the most important Jewish architects of his day. Held around 800 people, and it was a member of the United Synagogue, which means it was mainstream Orthodoxy. And to give credence to my theory about Hackney, Jewish Hackney being the successor to the Jewish East End, its heyday was in the 1950s, because then what you had were the children who had all been born to the people that had moved in, and you had over 500 members, nearly 550 members at that synagogue in the 1950s. By the late 60s, they still had over 350 members, and that's not because the Jewish community was still quite large in the area, it was because Poets Road had closed and the members of Poets Road had joined. But really, by the 1970s, the time was up for these large synagogues in Hackney. The massive move to the suburbs was well underway. From Hackney, they tended to go up to Cockfosters, Southgate, areas like that. And in 1977, became a Turkish mosque. And those of you that know the building will know there's a beautiful dome at the top. You can see the dome in this picture. The dome was added in 1983. And what's absolutely amazing about the building, in my opinion, is that most people, when they look at it, don't think, oh, that dome's been added on. It actually has been seamlessly attached to the synagogue. And so that's a building that's no longer a synagogue. But I want to show you now a building that is still a synagogue. I may have mentioned Chris Old Park. If you go out of the exit at Chris Old Park to Queen Elizabeth Walk, as you come out, you almost come immediately face to face with this synagogue. Now, this synagogue was established as a community in the early 1900s. And on Green Lanes, and then it moved to Burma Road. If any of you know Burma Road, it was there for some time. And then this building was built in the 1950s, which is why you have a foundation stone that is linked to a previous building. Now, this synagogue is very important for many reasons. One, it's very, very indicative of the move to Hackney of the ultra-Orthodox community. And when it comes to the ultra-Orthodox community in Hackney, there's one name that reverberates more than any other, and that's the Schoenfeld name. And Victor Schoenfeld came over to England. He was born in Hungary, came over as a learned man, became a rabbi at Burma Road, and unfortunately, he founded an organisation which is basically the Union of Hebrew Orthodox Orthodox Communities, which still exists today. And unfortunately, although he was a much loved man, he died in 1930, aged only 50. A year before, he had established a cemetery for his ultra-Orthodox community up in Enfield, Carter Hatch Lane. And sadly, his burial was the first burial to take place in the cemetery that he established. Now, when you think about synagogues in Hackney today, you've got in Stamford Hill, probably around 60 or so, they're almost uncountable because they're small little shtiebels in people's back rooms. But this synagogue, which is definitely in Stoke Newington, still exists. And you've also got in Stoke Newington two smaller but quite sort of growing quite rapidly communities, the New Stoke Newington Synagogue on New Stoke Newington Shore, which is linked to the Masorti movement, and also the North London Cahilla, which is linked to the progressive stroke liberal movement. So Stoke Newington and Stamford Hill are very, very distinct now when you actually look at the places of worship. But one of the glories, and it's not just in Stamford Hill and Hackney, one of the glories of London is that wherever you go, street names are often going to indicate to you something about the history of an area. And if you go to Lordship Road, you'll see an Evicta Mews. And Evicta Mews is named after the Victor Schoenfeld that I just mentioned. Evicta was his sort of Jewish name. Victor was his Anglicised name. And this is sort of relatively recent late 20th century housing for Victor Mews. It's on the site of a Victor school, because not only was he very involved in establishing synagogues, he also established the Jewish secondary school movement. Now, the school, the Victor School, as a secondary school, had quite a checkered history. Although it started very, very well, with great ambitions, by the 1950s, it wasn't doing so well. Victor's son, Solomon Schoenfeld, he wanted to go into law, but because his father died so young, and he was only 18 when he lost his father, he decided to follow his dad into the rabbinate, and also followed his dad into sort of being involved in education for the ultra-Orthodox community. And so a Victor school, he was the principal, Solomon Schoenfeld, and basically there was a headmaster that came along, a Mr. Crystal, who was much loved by the boys at the school, but wasn't much loved by Solomon Schoenfeld. Mr. Crystal was Jewish, but he wasn't Orthodox, and Solomon Schoenfeld, for whatever reason, took against him, and basically sacked him. He sacked him from the job. Well, what do you do if you're at school and your beloved headmaster is sacked? Well, you go on strike. And these are a couple of certificates from a young man who was at that school at the time of the strike. He's actually in the audience tonight. And basically they said, bring Mr. Crystal back. If you don't bring him back, we're not going to school. And so little Ronnie Cohen, who won one of Disney's running certificates and sewing certificates, was one of all the boys that went on strike. Mr. Crystal had to be reinstated, but he decided, because of the way he was treated, he wasn't going to let that school be successful anymore. And basically, if he didn't want to go to school, he didn't have to go to school. Nobody went to school, and ultimately the education authorities came and shut it down. It shut down a few years after the infamous strike, but you wouldn't know it just from that street sign, but that's the story that it holds. And linked to Solomon Schoenfeld and the schooling in Stoke Newington, there was also a primary school called a Victor Primary School. And the headmistress at the Victor Primary School was a lady called Judith Grinfeld. And you're probably wondering why I'm showing you this delightful little English village near Bedford, in just north of London. And it's Shefford. And that's the other glory of when you know stories about the history of the areas in which you live, that wherever you go in London or around the country, you can often find links when you're least expecting them. So curiously enough, I was actually in Shefford just last week, so these pictures I took literally last week. And the reason it's so famous is because Judith Grinfeld, who basically ran the primary school at the time of the Second World War, all schools were evacuated, she took over 600 kids, 25 staff, to this little town of Shefford. Nobody had ever seen a Jewish person before, let alone an ultra-Orthodox group of hundreds of Jewish kids. But Shefford basically took those kids under their wings. And you know, when they found they couldn't eat this and they couldn't eat that and they couldn't do this on Saturday and they couldn't do that, they basically adapted their lives to fit those kids. And a couple of years ago, the ultra-Orthodox community went back to Shefford and they erected this plaque inside the civic, it's not really a civic centre because Shefford's not that big, it's like a tiny little building, but it's where, you know, people get married and things like that, and you register birth, death and things. And they erected a plaque there to say thank you to the people of Shefford for looking after their children so well during the war, because they were there for the whole war, 1939 to 1945. And here she is, the Queen of Bessyakov, Judith Grinfeld herself. She was born in Hungary, brought up in Frankfurt, got married to Diane Grinfeld. He wasn't a Diane then, a judge, but he became one. And they went to Palestine in 1933, but didn't stay there very long, and came to London in 1934. He became a rabbi and became a very much revered religious leader. But Judith Grinfeld was very involved with both primary education and secondary education, particularly for girls. The ultra-Jewish community was very, very involved with good education for the girls, and that has continued to this day. And the Queen, she was known as Hamalka, which is a Jewish Hebrew for the Queen. And when you met her, from what I've heard from people, you either thought she was formidable or inspirational, charismatic. But there's no doubt about it, she truly was amazing. And She was widowed relatively young, and after she was widowed, she basically spent the next 20 years or so travelling the world, to Israel, around England, America, speaking about what you can do for girls' education, things like that. And she actually spoke at Madison Square Garden, and over 1,000 people went to listen to her. So, Judith Grunfeld, really, really special. She lived, if you know Chisholm Park, and you come out on Green Lanes, and you walk towards the castle, basically, the house doesn't exist anymore. It was knocked down and rebuilt, but that's where she lived with her husband. And still linked to the Jewish community and education, or looking after children. Some of you might know Bethune Road, mm-hmm. And near Dunsmuir Road, and Maud Nathan's home for little children was opened there in 1923 by a very, very important Jewish woman called Lily Montague. Lily Montague fired on lots of different cylinders. This isn't the vehicle to talk about her, but she opened it in 1923 for children. Small children, little children, who maybe didn't have a mother for one reason or another, the mother had died, or maybe she'd gone into hospital for a time, or just basically needed some time out and could look after her children. And the home was there in Stoke Newington for some years, and then it moved to Crystal Palace Road down in Sydenham. And it lasted until 1962. When literally there were just six children left, which is a sign of the times that families were more cohesive, there was more care. And but what I find interesting is, where did the name Maud Nathan come from here in Stoke Newington? Because she wasn't a Stoke Newington lady, I can tell you. She was actually a very important Jewish woman in New York from the Sephardi community, Spanish Portuguese community. And she was a great suffragist and a great proponent of women's rights. And she was obviously known for her hats, because if any of you know New York well, you'll know on one of the subway stations on 23rd Street on the R Line, you've got this magnificent purple and green hat, and that's Maud Nathan's hat, and because it's the millinery area in New York. So even if you're travelling in New York, you can actually make a link not just to Stoke Newington, but actually Jewish Stoke Newington at the same time. And Stoke Newington is also very, very famous in the Jewish world for maternity care. Now, this building isn't in Stoke Newington, doesn't exist anymore. It was demolished in 2012, a little bit of a controversy there. But this was the Jewish maternity home in Whitechapel on Underwood Road. And it was opened in 1912, extended in the late 1920s. You can see that clearly. The gabled building is 1912, the bigger building, which is sort of in the foreground from the late 1920s. And this was known as Mother Levy's, after the district superintendent of the area. By the 1930s, it was renamed the Bisted Memorial Hospital, because Lord Bisted was one of the key funders. And if you don't know the Bisted family, basically the first Lord Bisted was Marcus Samuel, who, if you haven't heard of him, he basically founded Shell Oil. He was the one that invented oil tankers. But they were big funders of it. By the 1930s, basically with the move from the East End of the Jewish community, the Bisted maternity home really needed somewhere new, where the young mums and the mums-to-be were going to go. And it was decided it should be Stoke Newington, because as I mentioned, that's where the Jewish community were consolidating themselves in North London. Well, the Second World War intervened, and they were evacuated, the hospital was evacuated to Hampton Court. So you will actually find quite a lot of Jewish people around. They're quite senior now, but they were born on their birth certificate, it says Hampton Court. It does not say Hampton Court Palace, it says Hampton Court, but if you want to pretend, I'm sure there are a lot of people that pretended, and why not? But after the war, it did move to Stoke Newington on Lordship Road. And this is the Bisted Memorial Hospital, opened in 1947, much, much loved by the Jewish community, but badly served by the National Health Service, if I may be so bold as to say. There were always plans to extend it, there were plans to bring in more operating theatres, there were plans to bring in more beds, but the funding never came. And so what happened was that it was going to become a bigger hospital with lots more facilities, but the funding never came to allow that to happen. So ultimately, it actually had to close. It's called closing by stealth, it's a phrase that's used. And one of the key statistics that we can tell about how the number of children being born there had decreased is the number of circumcisions that took place there. So in 1969, because that's well documented, in 1969, 1970, and 1971, the number of circumcisions, so this is linked to little boys being born, went from 37 down to 33, and then almost halved within 1 year to 17. So this is in the early 1970s, and so in 1974, it closed down. The building was demolished. You meet a lot of people who were born at the Beers did. A lot of people still alive today born there. And if you go there today, that's the building that you'll probably recognise. So the building was demolished, but the land was granted back to the Jewish community. So what you have on that site now is a variety of social services, mother and baby units, special needs centre, all linked to the Haredi ultra-Orthodox community there today. And next door, you have Schoenfeld Square. Now, if Victor got a muse, his son Solomon, this is a picture of Solomon Schoenfeld there, gets a square. Now, Solomon Schoenfeld, when you meet people that knew him, you'll always get very differing reviews of him. He was quite a prickly character. He lacked patience, and basically whatever he wanted done, he got done. And but he powered on lots of different cylinders. He, as I said, took over the rabbi's pulpit from his father for the Adas Yisrael. He also became principal of the Avigdor schools. During the Second World War, he founded Hasmonean Secondary School. It's a secondary school that's still going today as for the Orthodox community. And he made a good marriage. He married the daughter of Chief Rabbi Hertz, Judith Hertz. And that's actually one of the reasons he didn't live in Stoke Newington. When Solomon Schoenfeld got married, his marital home was in Highgate. And what I read was it was like a compromise between him and his wife. His wife was born and brought up like in Northwest London, Golders Green. Solomon Schoenfeld knew Stoke Newington and Hackney, and so Highgate seemed like a nice compromise. But because he had the ear of the chief rabbi during the period of the Second World War and immediately afterwards, he headed up the chief rabbi's religious emergency committee. And there's a lot of work being done, a lot of research that's done, a lot of knowledge about all the different groups of people who escaped Nazi Europe, who got refuge here in England, particularly the kinder transport people talk about, the boys that came up over after the war, the survivors. But Solomon Schoenfeld was particularly involved with bringing religious people over, making sure that they had places to pray, making sure that they had access to kosher food, things like this. Because don't forget, a lot of Jewish people coming over, that wasn't a priority for them. But he wanted, for those people that needed it, they should get it. And he also arranged a vast number of of groups of people who could leave Nazi Europe and Russia and move them elsewhere. So a lot of them moved to Shanghai. He moved around 500 people from Lithuania over to Shanghai. And he actually petitioned the government vociferously to make a home in all different places, like in Africa, to get a homeland or a refuge for Jewish people so they could escape. But because the war effort basically overtook Parliament, those efforts came to nothing. But he's remembered here at Schoenfeld Square. Schoenfeld Square is visited from people all over the world who are looking to see how you can make housing for different generations. You know, often we think in terms of accommodation for children or maybe accommodation for senior people in care homes. What Schoenfeld Square, named in his honour, does, it has multi-generational facilities for living, residential. So you've got places for elderly people, you've got mother and babies, you've got children, and you have a place for Jewish people with special needs as well. So that's how his name lives on. And I'm just going to end with a few other sort of miscellaneous associations with Jewish Stoke Newington that you can go and see today. Some of you, I'm sure, know the beloved egg stores, founded back in 1948 by the Freelander family. The glorious thing about the egg stores is that it just hasn't changed. I mean, I think the food is within sell-by date now, but it just hasn't changed. I lived in South Tottenham for a time. That's my little bit of... I lived in South Tottenham for a time. I used to, on a Sunday morning, get on the bus and go up to the egg stores, and I swear it looks exactly the same as it did all those years ago, which was decades ago. But what I love about it, it's a kosher store. Everything's kosher and supervised. But this fascia, that lovely sort of, it looks like early 1960s to me, that pale blue and black fascia, and long may it last. There was a big fire there a few years ago, actually, and everybody thought, oh, save that fascia, and it was. And the egg stores, by the way, is just almost opposite John's Abney Park Cemetery. So any of you that visit John's Cemetery, you'll know the egg stores. And then if you cross the road and go down Manor Road, if anybody knows Manor Road at the top, you'll see Star Hatters for Samet hats. And although this isn't really linked to the trendy Stoke Newington that so many of you probably frequent, it's very much linked to the Stamford Hill part of Stoke Newington, Stamford Hill. And the hats are really, really important. I've never heard of a Samet hat, and Ronnie had never heard of a Samet hat. That's it for Ronnie, who was on strike in 1955. And because it's not an Orthodox shop, we had to wait. I couldn't go in and ask. I had to take Ronnie with me, and he went in and asked. And a Samet hat, you can see a picture of one there, is like an everyday hat for the ultra-Orthodox community. But the glorious thing is, if you go down Manor Road and you look at Star Hatters, if you want to buy a hat or not, is literally next door, you've got that wonderful chimney. I'm sure some of you know it. It says Politi on it. And if you look at the top of the building, just at the top of Manor Road, near Stoke Newington Station, you can see a Star of David and the date 1911. And the reason I'm very fond of this building is one that has actually survived, which I think is great. But you can see the tins of Turkish Delight there. And this building, it's now actually a kosher bakery called Fresh Bake. And when the building links to a chap called David Politi. Now, David Politi was born and brought up in Corfu. He came over to England in 1862, went up to Manchester, set up a confectionery business, making jams and sweets, came down to London to get married at Bevis Marks Synagogue, which was a big sort of Sephardi synagogue. It still exists today on the edge of the city. And but then came down to London. He set up his first sweet factory near Brownswood Road. So again, if you come out of Clissold Park onto Green Lane, sort of that side of the area. And then he needed somewhere bigger. And what I love about the building is he built it in 1911, and he was so proud of his Jewish heritage that you often find a date on a building. That's not unusual. But he put the Star of David there as well. The Turkish Delight was kosher in the sense you have to be very careful with Turkish Delight if you're vegetarian or kosher, because sometimes it's made with gelatin. But his Turkish Delight didn't have gelatin in it. Anybody could eat it. And the red tin is the rose, the green is the creme de menthe, and the brown is for almond. And I don't know all your different memories of childhood, but I remember our Politi, they were like not real wood, but funny wood boxes. And you opened it up, and white stuff flew everywhere with that little lovely wooden fork. And of course, the white stuff was icing sugar mixed with corn flour, so all those lovely squares of Turkish Delight wouldn't stick together. So the Politis continued making sweets and jams and Turkish Delight to the late 1970s in that building. So a little piece of Jewish food history for you. And
we have Politis over Christmas.
Did you? Absolutely, it's Christmas. Absolutely, Politi is Christmas. Thank you. And again, some of you might recognise this. It says Coronation Avenue. The picture above is what people see from the street. It was built, Coronation Avenue is a block of flats, five-story block of flats, built in 1903 as Stoke Newington Estate by the 4% Industrial Dwellings Company. Now, the 4% Industrial Dwellings Company was founded in the mid-1880s by the first Jewish Lord Rothschild, Lord Nathaniel Rothschild. And the 4% indicates if you invested in his venture to provide affordable housing for the Jewish industrious poor, you would get a 4% return on your money. Basically, he felt that a lot of property developers were making too much money, maybe 7%, 8%, 9%. He felt 4% was more than adequate return. And the first blocks, what was surprised to hear in the 1880s, were in the Jewish East End, in Whitechapel, and then later in my name, Stepney. But it was the 4% who started that pull to pull Jewish people from the East End, where it was very, very overcrowded. Amir mentioned the two up, two downs in the East End in his talk. And the 4% pulled the Jewish people out. They established this estate here in Stoke Newington in 1903, and of course in Dalston, Navarino Mansions, just a year or so later. And again, you know, this was for the industrious poor. These were, this is not for the down and outs, these were for people that earned money on a regular basis, that made them affordable, but made them aesthetically pleasing. That to me is what is so wonderful about those endeavours. They were providing for the poor, but it still looked good. But Coronation Avenue in Stoke Newington, of course, is remembered for a very different reason. On the 13th of October 1914, it was bombed, it was hit by a bomb, and beneath beneath the buildings, it was used as a public shelter. Hundreds and hundreds of people went to that shelter every night. There were three rooms, it was public shelter number five, and there were three rooms, and it took a direct hit. Today, people still don't know how many people exactly were killed, but it's estimated at around 170. And if you look at the records in Stoke Newington of fatalities in the Blitz, all fatalities, obviously, are terrible. But in fact, if this incident had not happened, Stoke Newington would have had a relatively low fatality rate during the Blitz of the Second World War. This is about 80% of the people that were killed in your area were here. And because it was a very Jewish area, a lot of the people who died were Jewish. And just recently, I'm sure some of you are aware, a plaque was erected in their memory on the mansions. And again, in John's cemetery, there's the Coronation Avenue Memorial. And if you look at the memorial, it's not just for the people that died at Coronation Avenue, it's for the other incidents in Stoke Newington as well. But most of the people that died in Coronation Avenue incident lived in just 12 streets, all within, not far from here, within this area. You'll see Jewish names, you'll see non-Jewish names. One of the byproducts, though, of that incident was that a number of, you know, the people weren't identified, the authorities had to deal with a lot of burials very quickly, and research over the last few years has found that a number of non-Jewish people were buried in the Jewish cemeteries, and a number of Jewish people were buried in Abney Park, which of course is absolutely okay because it's totally non-denominational in Abney Park. But they have since found out that people that were buried as Jewish people were actually other people altogether. And it's caused some distress for some members of the family, but actually everything is gradually coming, all the records are gradually coming to the fore. So a very poignant memorial there in John's cemetery. And I'm just going to end with a bit of food, why not? A bit of honey. Some years ago, I keep mentioning Ronnie, sort of sitting in the corner there, he was a chief exec of a synagogue, and his PA gave him a present for the Jewish New Year, Rosh Hashanah, which is actually coming up shortly, and it's customary to have sweet things on the Jewish New Year, particularly honey. And she gave him that jar of honey, and look what it says, Stamford Hill honey. And Ronnie said, that's very nice, thank you, I was going to hold up in Stamford Hill, stroke Stoke Newington. And then he looked at the label, 26 St Kilda's Road. Ronnie said, what? I cannot believe that. 26 St Kilda's Road, honey made there. He was born and brought up at 52 St Kilda's Road. He said, I couldn't believe it. Anyway, I, of course, on my travels to Stoke Newington, Stamford Hill, travelled up to 26. I used to knock on the door, no answer. I just peeped through the gate. Nobody told me not to. I walked through the gate, and in the back garden at number 26, I saw goats. Hens, chickens. It was like a farm in the middle of the ultra-Orthodox Jewish area. I thought, amazing. Anyway, kept on going back. And actually, Ruth is in the audience tonight. And on a tour I did for Ruth and her community, we were able to go in and we actually met the lovely, lovely gentleman who makes the honey, Joseph Schneck. He's absolutely an adorable gentleman. He is ultra-Orthodox, but he loves animals. And he has his goats, and he's got a number of aviaries, both in his back garden, elsewhere in Stoke Newington, one on the roof of his dad's house. And he continues to make honey there. But for you and for Amir, And for this talk about Jewish Folk Newington, what is the greatest thing that happened over the last couple of years? Stamford Hill Honey is now Stoke Newington Honey. Yes! So I thought, what better, what more could you ask for? So everybody, Stamford Hill has morphed into Stoke Newington. Thank you everybody for your attention.